Hey, this is Molly Cox, tight end for the Indianapolis Colts, and you're listening to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Welcome in. The Fantasy Footballers back with you, Andy, Mike, and Jason, fresh off a gigantic weekend full of fantasy football, none of which included Justin Jackson's production. Two straight weeks of full tilt on this side of the table. I spent the week analyzing games with a critical eye, looking at opportunities before our trade deadline, and I identified Justin Jackson as a trade target. I pursued such a player and acquired him for the purpose of a very contested league of record matchup. And then the dream for my opponent came true, where a player was hurt on the first play of the game. And he goosed me, and I lost by a margin he could have easily overcome. Thank you, Al Borland, I assume.
You're welcome.
That was the live sound of Justin Jackson.
Oh, yeah, not everything went well this week. It was a lot of good football. I mean, some fun football. And then it really ended with
Sunday night?
That Sunday night game that was going to be awesome between Tom Brady and Drew Brees
takes two to tango.
Oh my word, that was some of the worst football. It was like the movie Signs. It was like this great, awesome, and then all of a sudden the end was a huge letdown.
The movie Signs?
Oh, yeah. You have angered the M. Night Shyamalan truther over there.
Spoiler alert here. Please turn it off if the statute of limitations. But the aliens were allergic to water on the planet full of water that they went to take over. That was the end of the movie.
You thought that was a good ending?
I freaking love that movie.
Well, the movie was great. That's what I'm saying.
The ending was great, too.
The aliens.
The thing that could destroy the aliens covers 80% of the planet.
So you're in on this hate, Mike?
That'd be like us going to take over a cyanide planet. Like, I love, look at this, how great this planet
okay.
is.
We got to get your 10% of resources.
First of all, these aliens, they may never have seen water before. How would they know that they're taking over a planet?
They have interstellar travel technology. They don't know they're on.
If I said it once, I'll say it a million times. Don't try to get into the heads of aliens, all right? You don't know what their motivations were.
But that was what I comp this weekend of football, because it was awesome.
I didn't think I could be in a worse mood than what Justin Jackson put me in. And now you tread on my favorite M. Night movie. I freaking love that movie. All right.
The movie is great. The ending is trash.
We're not friends. All right. It's Monday Punday.
Oh.
I like this one. We scoured the social media and we found some great puns to describe this weekend. So I'll begin here. Hip hip Murray.
Or Chase Dredmond.
Oh, wow. He was double digits. Mm.
He was okay, but he wasn't great.
Tomb Brady.
Oh, Tomb Brady's great. The Tampa Bay Yuccaneers. Come on.
Tampa Bay Succaneers.
Oh, that's two layers deep. Melvin Gordon.
Thrill Fuller.
I think we've got to experience that one before.
The flying wee.
Lames Connor.
Oh, Michael Taw. Meh.
That's all right.
That one's not very good.
Mary Judy. That's good for the season.
Yeah. Jerry Woody.
Do we have a booty scootin' Jake Luton?
We do.
Booty scootin' Jake Luton. Free.
And we'll finish with Devontae Wish I Had 'ems. All right.
It's not bad.
Oh, so
booty scootin' Jake Luton.
That's ridiculous. That spin move, though. Cam could learn a thing or two. Look, a lot of people out there, they look at our job and they look at what we have to do and they say, mm-hmm. you are the luckiest people on the face of the earth. And most moments of life, they're correct. But tonight we have to watch the Patriots-Jets play football. And
I feel like we're being punished.
Yeah, do you have one of those devices that hold the eyes open? Do you got one of those?
No,
yeah.
In fairness,
Clockwork Orange style.
In fairness to football, we thought Sunday Night Football was going to be outstanding.
That's true.
And it was as unwatchable as any football I've seen in a long time, whereas tonight we expect it to be just trash.
So how many of your teams have players in tonight's game?
Oh, thankfully, none of them.
Yeah, I imagine that. Well, that's part of what makes tonight less exciting is probably not a lot of starts out there, but maybe some Cam Newtons. I know Al Borland is facing Frank Gore, so that's a treat.
You need Frank Gore to score fewer than 4 points?
That is correct.
I think I would put that at 50-50. I don't know.
Maybe. Maybe.
Kalen Ballage making an appearance
this
weekend.
Oh, man. Oh, we did it. We did it again.
I know.
Adam Gase let somebody go, and then they're awesome. What? How is this possible?
Let's get into the rewind.
Weekly Rewind.
He is the opposite Sean McVay.
Does this mean that we should, in dynasty leagues, go trade for Sam Darnold and Mims and just get every Jet you can in a dynasty league because you know he's not going to be there long term?
First of all, Kalen Ballage did not escape and learn how to catch footballs. So
that's
there
true.
Is that. Weekly Rewind, lots of news to talk about. I'm still tilting over your signs take. It sucks so bad. All right, Christian McCaffrey.
You're the ending? Yes.
So upset. Christian McCaffrey, Jason, this is real. After missing the month with an ankle injury, after showing up and being the same old Christian McCaffrey, he could miss more time with a shoulder injury that he suffered yesterday. if those of you listening are in shock, join us because this was something that broke from Ian Rappaport about an hour ago, and his status is now in doubt.
It is the worst. I mean, you have waited for so – look, in our league of record – I'm the Christian McCaffrey manager. I've struggled through the injury.
You've endured.
I've endured. I've come out on top.
Yeah.
I'm in first place in the league, and now I've got CMC back, and I watched the game last night. It's like, yes, he's so good. Yeah. And then I come in this morning, and you guys are like, CMC's injured. And I just assumed you're being super funny, guys. Oh, you're so funny. And he's injured. It's not fair.
Sorry. Justin Jackson injured his knee. Taken out after a snap. David Montgomery, concussion in the fourth quarter, also on my roster. Mm. David Johnson exited with a concussion. This was disappointing. He had great opportunity in this game. And so, well, you know, you got to monitor, Duke Johnson.
We'll see. I mean, it's
for that one.
Yeah, it's the concussion. He'll have time to get back, but Duke should be picked up in the meantime.
Yeah, that's called the convenient concussion. Get it early in the game so you have maximum time for next week. That's what they try to do. Big Ben, knee injury, able to return. He's Big Ben. He'll be all right. Matthew Stafford exited with a concussion, so he'll have to be in the protocol as well. Kyle Allen, really gruesome dislocation of the ankle.
It was so bizarre, too. It was the defender, like...
His leg went flying into him.
Leg scissored Kyle Allen's leg. And dislocated his ankle. We're gonna. I did see a report that they're saying it's gonna be Alex Smith next week. So and Smith kind of lost the game there at the end, but he looked all right. Looked all right.
Just I want him in like the lower body cast for the game.
Right.
I want him pre-protected. Does he need any precautionary surgeries? I know we've talked about that. Could we take care of?
I think he's had enough.
All right. Yes. All right. Noah Fant returned after leaving with an ankle injury.
He's had this ankle injury all year. It's like, get healthy, man.
Albert O, though, suffered a knee injury, did not return. This could be serious. So Noah Fant will have potentially more snaps or opportunities. Preston Williams, foot injury. Laviskus Chenault, hamstring injury. And, boy, a lot of injuries this week.
Yep.
A report that Nick Chubb and Miles Sanders are expected to return to practice this week.
Yeah, there we go. Some good news.
They could be back out there. And then Baker. Baker put on the COVID list. A close contact should be okay. They're on bye.
Yeah, and so he can be cleared by Wednesday. So we're expecting Baker Mayfield will be back. But this is fantastic news, man. Both Nick Chubb and Miles Sanders coming back for fantasy lineups. That's great.
You must not have Kareem Hunt on your roster.
Kareem Hunt was – dude, you should be happy. Kareem Hunt was better.
I know.
When he could split.
Little touchdown dependent, though. But, yeah. I hear you.
But they were flowing.
No, they're both great plays the rest of the season. Let's talk studs.
This week's Fantasy Stud Muffins.
Kyler Murray.
Woo. Whoa, doggy.
21 for 26, 283 and 3, 11 for 106 on the ground, another rushing touchdown.
If your running back got 106 yards and a touchdown, you are thrilled.
Yes.
If your quarterback got 283 yards and 3 touchdowns, you are thrilled.
Yes.
You just got two thrilling players in one, and it is awesome.
So much thrill.
So much thrill. He's the first player in NFL history to have a rushing and passing touchdown 7 of the first 8 games of the year.
Ooh, specific stats.
Yeah, I didn't realize that when I got – I started the stat, and then I got to the end, and I didn't like it, but yeah, I had to finish.
He's dominating.
Yeah, Buffalo, Seattle, New England the next 3 weeks. We had the return. Josh Stallion, 31 for 38, 415 and 3, scored on the ground as well.
Came through. Sometimes fantasy football is easy.
Start of the week, baby.
Sometimes it's easy when you see Josh Allen matched up against a defense giving up 350 passing yards.
That seems
easy.
And
it worked out.
Yeah, that seems easy. Now, when you look at what happened with the Cowboys and Steelers game.
Sometimes it's not easy.
Football, man. Football.
What? The cow? What?
Yeah, that was a close one. Patrick Mahomes keeps doing it. Next week he won't, though. That's my prediction.
They are on bye.
Yeah. Drew Locke, Jason, what do you think of Drew Locke here? 25 for 48, 313 and 2. His second halves are a lot better than his first half.
It's not just the second half.
Exactly. It's the fourth quarter.
Yes.
Apparently he doesn't know how to play football for three of them, and then he's great in the fourth quarter.
How do you not play him next week?
Next week against the Raiders, I guess you can throw him in there. He ended with a great fantasy day. If you were watching the game, he was not good for the vast majority of it, which is why they were down by so much and he had to throw so much at the end of the game. But
yeah.
Atlanta is certainly prone to giving late game comebacks.
Who do you like more, Drew Locke or Mason Rudolph?
Oh, Drew Locke. What?
Oh, okay.
Oh, man.
I think they're in the same fraternity.
What?
Oh, no.
I don't know.
That's an insult to Drew.
I agree.
Drew Locke's the worst.
He might be one of the worst, but not when you bring up Mason Rudolph.
That's how I feel. Like it's like saying, I'm not a huge fan of Drew Locke, but then you bring up, oh, man, Mason Rudolph. I can't stand
not a big fan.
That guy.
He's terrible.
Aaron Rodgers.
Not terrible.
Spectacular Thursday night. Teddy Bridgewater got it done. 36 out of 49. And 310 and 2 had a rushing touchdown in this game.
That Carolina team.
That was a fun game.
It was a great game. Super well coached. I mean, they were going after the Kansas City Chiefs. They were trying everything they could to win. Fake punts, going for it on fourth down, converting on all of them. It still wasn't enough, but the team looked just absolutely excellent.
And now maybe no Christian McCaffrey for a week, but he changes that offense tremendously. Big Ben, Deshaun Watson, Drew Brees. Drew Brees. Woo!
Yeah, Brees, man.
It was a breeze for him last night. Just no big deal. 4 touchdowns, just 222 yards because it was easy.
Remember when he was injured this week?
Yeah. Yep, and was playing the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Yeah.
He has San Francisco this week, but after that, Atlanta, Denver, Atlanta, 3 straight weeks with Michael Thomas back. So,
yeah,
it could be
nice.
Really, really nice for Drew Brees. And Matt Ryan, did he have Julio Jones?
Yes.
Okay, he had a great fantasy game.
That's how it works.
So any other quarterbacks you guys want to look at, or are we good to move on to the Dalvin Cook portion of the show?
Oh, man. Oh brother.
Dalvin Cook.
He's so good.
22 for 206 and 2. And it's not like you don't come into the game knowing that Dalvin Cook is the plan, right?
Right.
Right.
And then you get Chicago this week, then Dallas, Carolina, Jacksonville. Dalvin Cook is going to carry many a fantasy team for weeks to come.
It is not fun playing against Dalvin Cook.
56 touches, 478 yards, and 6 touchdowns over the last 2 weeks.
His last 2 weeks, he's on pace.
Oh, I want to hear this.
Yes. So over the last 2 weeks, that would be a pace.
Over the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, no, I want this. I want this pace really bad.
All right. He's on pace for 2,952 rushing yards.
2,952. Got it.
40 touchdowns on rushing? The ground, okay. Rushing touchdowns. He's going to add 872 receiving yards,
yeah.
And 8 receiving touchdowns. That's his 60-game pace over the last two. I mean, these last two
yeah,
games.
Will he hit 3,000? That's what we've been wondering.
Silly.
He's so good.
I mean,
he's so good.
The reality is, it's not. I mean, these last 2 weeks have been outrageously good, but the entire season has been phenomenal. He has.
You want anybody else in fantasy football the rest of the season?
I mean, maybe,
yeah, maybe Kamara.
You could say Kamara.
I don't want Kamara over Cook the rest of the season.
Yeah, I don't. I
Michael Thomas coming
it's,
back.
It's all just for Cook. It's just the injury risk. We've seen him leave too many games in too many years. And so you worry it's going to happen again. But outside of that, if he's out there, he's been phenomenal. Week 2 against the Indianapolis Colts, he was the running back 17, which is fine. That's you're,
right.
You're maybe you're not excited, but that's fine. Every other week, he's been top 10.
Ridiculous. Christian McCaffrey, 18 for 69 and a touchdown on the ground, 10 targets, 10 for 82 and a touchdown through the air. And really, we had heard that Mike Davis is going to split opportunities with him. It didn't really manifest. I mean, you didn't see Mike Davis really get involved until the very end when McCaffrey had been out. 71% of snaps, 82% of running back touches. It's all pretend when you say you're going to take him off the field. Then you put him on the field and you go, oh, no, we need that. And so, unfortunately, the shoulder injury, maybe he'll be back after the Tampa Bay game and you'll get Detroit, Minnesota before his bye week. But hopefully you get him back before the bye week. I mean, that would be unfortunate if he was out longer. Some other honorable mentions at the running back position to throw out there. James Robinson.
I think that one's worth noting. I know it was the Houston Texans, and their defense is not the strongest part of the
25
team.
25 carries.
Is that, yeah, exactly. The opportunities were there for Robinson. The targets did kind of evaporate. Only 2 targets, no receptions with Jake Luton. But he will get to take on the Green Bay Packers, who have a porous run defense as well. So, I mean, that's good news. At least you get another week out of James Robinson. This is kind of a paycheck to paycheck here with Robinson, not knowing exactly what's going to happen with Pittsburgh in 2 weeks.
Robinson but is...
I think they put him on salary now. Like, yeah. He's not a contract employee for your fantasy team.
No, he's an every week start. I'll start him 2 weeks from now against Pittsburgh, the great defense, because he's just been... phenomenal. You look at his entire season and he's
giving 25 opportunities every game.
Absolutely. And I mean, that's the last, if you look at the last 6 games, there's been one where he's had fewer than 20 opportunities.
That game went to the wire too. That was a pretty fun game. All right. Before we talk about wide receiver studs, I want to thank today's sponsors. Today we want to thank Simply Safe. Look, everybody wants to keep their home and family safe. I know Brooks is in that category. Brooks just bought a new home.
He's trying to keep all that jewelry safe.
Yeah, he's a big
drip,
big,
drip,
big
Brooks.
Drip, drip. Yep. Yeah, him and Dez Bryant. They got the bling. He just signed up for Simply Safe. That's right.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. And what I like about Simply Safe personally is I like just not having to think about it anymore. That's what once you get Simply Safe and you set it up, this is not some long-term contract. It's just kind of automated. I like the automated life, and they've got your back. You get the cameras and the sensors and the professional monitoring, and then I don't think about it anymore. It's just done. And you can set it up yourself. Have you set it up yet, Brooks?
That's what I did.
You did? Okay.
Dude, you got to keep those gems protected.
I know. I know. You got to get it up quick before somebody comes and tries to get it. But they, yeah, they take care of you. And right now our listeners get a free home security camera when you purchase a SimpliSafe system at simplisafe.com/footballers. You also get a 60-day risk-free trial, so there's nothing to lose. Visit simplisafe.com/footballers for your free security camera today. That's simplisafe.com/footballers. Don't come after Brooks' jewels, man.
You'll know. Hands off.
Hands off the jewels. All right. We've got some wide receiver studs this week. How about 18 targets for Tyreek Hill?
Whew.
How about 9 for 113 and 2?
And I know everyone's – if you got Tyreek Hill on your team, you're super happy about this.
Yeah. This is not breaking news that he's good.
No, but Kansas City doesn't run the ball anymore. What happened? What happened over the last couple of weeks? They're like, you know what we need? We need to shore up this running back room. Let's go get Le'Veon Bell. He's a free agent. Got cut. Let's bring him in. And then we will never run the ball
again. Hold on. Maybe I can figure this thing out. Maybe they pick up the Shady like last year and Lev like this year so that they can run somebody inefficient out there and justify statistically that the man who's going to make $100 bazillion should throw the ball in every play.
So Mahomes, this is a Mahomes conspiracy. So, oh, go get that guy.
Or it could be they go, you know, we're not happy with our run game. It hasn't been working as well as we hoped when we drafted Clyde Edwards-Helaire. Let's go get Lev Bell. See if he's got it. Nope, he don't. He don't have it. And so they're not happy with their run game, and they're just throwing the ball more. And because then, that's what they should be doing. They should cut Clyde Edwards-Helaire. I mean, just cut every running back on the roster.
They should cut Clyde Edwards-Helaire.
Yes, they should just go full all wide receivers.
I still believe my theory, because why else would you run Darrell Williams out there so much?
Yeah, fair.
Anyways, yeah, I mean. The Clyde Edwards-Helaire thing, he obviously didn't come up in the studs, and he probably doesn't come up in the stinkers because he scored.
No, he was the running back 17 so far.
He scored a passing touchdown, which is really, he probably said, guys, throw me the ball at least.
Yes.
But he should be a discussion because, Lev is not good, but they aren't running the football, and he hasn't gotten into the end zone except for this past week, really. So where are you? I mean, I'm not acquiring Clyde based on this game. I think maybe I cash out.
I think Clyde will continue to be what he's been the whole season, which is a solid option at running back, not a spectacular, great, phenomenal fantasy asset that the fantasy community hoped when he was drafted and to this team. He's just going to be an okay. So you just hold him. You keep playing him. And I'm cutting Lev Bell. There's no point in having him.
He's not going to do anything to impress fantasy players.
And if you hadn't seen the snaps or things like that, Darrell Williams was running ahead of Le'Veon Bell yesterday.
Yeah, both literally and figuratively, correct?
Yeah.
I mean, goodness. All right, Davante Adams, he's been spectacular. He's the past 3 weeks, wide receiver 2, wide receiver 2, wide receiver 3. 10 for 173 and 1. The Dalvin Cook of the wide receiver position at this moment in time.
Mm-hmm.
Hey! Look at this guy.
Yes.
DJ Chark, he just needed to get rid of that jort-wearing Minshew.
Minshew is too short.
Yeah, that's why we brought you the analysis
the
last week. The
height-based argument.
That Jake Luton, very tall. DJ Chark, very tall.
Jason brought it up. Chark probably had a weed allergy.
Yes.
And you get Luton free in there. And 7 for 146 and 1. Now, one big play, but still involved in this offense. He looked good, but has Green Bay Pittsburgh coming up.
He had,
are you getting out? Are you cashing in? I think I would. I think I would try to upgrade.
I'm certainly willing to do that if you can, pull the wool over someone's eyes.
Go get DeAndre Hopkins after that week.
For one performance here with DJ Chark. The important number here to me, I mean, 7 for 146 and 1. That's important. 12 targets. Well, you had a brand new quarterback. You don't know what he's going to do. You can hypothesize, like maybe he's going to dump it down to LaVisca Chenault the whole bunch. But no, like Luton tried to at least open up the game. The Green Bay secondary is better than the Houston Texans, so we'll see if it can continue moving forward. But it's signs of life that this quarterback preferred targeting DJ Chark.
I'm going to put you on tilt, Mike.
All right.
Curtis Samuel went 9 for 105 and 1.
Yeah, he did.
Curtis Samuel has been good for at least the past 3 weeks.
Yep.
Curtis Samuel or DJ Moore in your lineup rest of season?
I don't know if you can do a rest of season, but...
Oh, I just did.
but I will say you can... Curtis Samuel, you have to start him at this point.
DJ Moore, 3 targets for... He was 2 for 18. Last week, he had 2 catches.
Mm-hmm.
Robbie Anderson still had 13 targets, 9 catches.
Yeah, over the last 5 weeks, Curtis Samuel is the leading fantasy scorer at wide receiver for the Panthers. DJ Moore is actually 2nd, and Robbie Anderson is now 3rd over the last 5 games. They're an offense that has 3 really solid wide receivers, and it looks like they're not partial to saying so-and-so has to get the ball. Mm-hmm. They're going to use whoever makes the most sense that game.
And I also think that those numbers really show fantasy players why you don't look at numbers like that. Because DJ Moore had basically, he's had stinkers, and he had 2 big games in that stretch, and you'd much rather have had Robbie Anderson through that duration, would you not have? I mean, consistency on a week-to-week basis versus getting gooses?
Yeah, I mean, well, 2 weeks ago, one of those horrific games you're talking about, he had less than a point fewer than Robbie Anderson. So this last week was really the first week in that
stretch. How would you rate them rest of season?
How would I rate them rest of season? I would probably put it in reverse order still. I still think I would go Robbie first just because of targets. He's looked good. It's tough between DJ Moore and Curtis Samuel, though. 1A1 or 2A, 2B there.
Mm-hmm. Jerry Jeudy, 14 targets, 7 for 125. A lot of people were calling for the breakout game this week, and they got it. You like him rest of the season?
Yeah, I mean, he's a talented guy. I'm still not thrilled with having to rely on Drew Lock, but coming up here against the Raiders, I think it's another good matchup, and it's nice to see a rookie continue developing, and obviously, historically, rookie wide receiver second half of the year is where they break out more than the first half of the year. So there's great signs here.
All right, Will Fuller has scored in 6 straight games. He went 5 for 101. Brandon Cooks had another great game. Before the show, we were talking about both of those players. They've been outstanding for weeks now.
Yeah, I mean, week after week after week, both guys are getting it done. You can't look at one's great game and say, oh, that means the other is not, you know, that this guy's the one you want. You want both players.
Keenan Allen went 9 for 103 again.
Oh, man.
What about Christian Kirk here? Christian Kirk getting it done week after week, 5 for 123 and 1.
Well, and this was different, too. I mean, you had high volume. You had 8 targets. You had 2 tremendous downfield shots as well, not just we're 5 yards away, and Christian Kirk is the one who comes away with the touchdown. So this is a very positive sign as well.
Yeah, it's basically what he did against Dallas a couple weeks ago when he had the big play, the bomb. You know, they take a deep shot with him a couple times a game because they really don't want to do that with Andy Isabella.
Mm. Yeah, it's one of them works.
You know, it'd be one thing, and I know we're Cardinal fans out here, so it hurts to know that DK Metcalf went a pick later than Andy Isabella, but it really doesn't help that there's such a size disparity between the two players.
Physically or emotionally?
Physically. Oh. Yeah, I mean.
It's like, did you look at these guys when you drafted?
It just hurts. I mean, DK's sitting there chasing down Buda Baker, running a 4.29 at 9 feet tall, and Andy Isabella's fumbling kickoffs and disappearing.
But
running the wrong routes.
Yeah, Christian Kirk, his involvement has been great. It's back-to-back games with 8 targets. He's got outlandishly 5 touchdowns in the last 3 games, and the upcoming schedule, Buffalo and Seattle, I think you're going to want to start most Cardinals in those games.
Yeah, Kyler's just moving. I mean, they're the number one scoring offense in football. They've scored over 30 points, I think, 4 straight weeks. DK Metcalf, he's on pace for 86, 15, 76, and 16 touchdowns.
Woo-hoo!
So, breakout year for DK. McLaurin, great again, 7 for 115 and 1. He just gets it done. And he'll continue to do so because Alex Smith,
yeah,
if he doesn't have it physically, he's certainly still smart, and he knows there's one player to throw the ball to.
Now, what the breakout – oh, no, that was Case Keenum. Oh, that was Case Keenum. I'm sorry. In my head, I was confusing the timelines.
I get it. I get that confusion. Yeah. Case Keenum and, well, it was and
like,
Alex Smith.
It's like, when did Alex Smith get hurt? And it was because Terry McLaurin's rookie year, he started with Case Keenum. I mean, and the truth is, if Alex Smith – can get his swag back. I mean, it's you're still talking about a player who had a life-threatening injury, a limb-threatening injury. So it's going to take him some time to work back. But if we have we're going to get some full weeks of practice where Alex Smith is the starter, that could turn into an upgrade here for Terry McLaurin, who has been dragging the Washington offense with him because he is so excellent.
Well, I mean, J.D. McKissick's helping out too.
Sure.
No, the goal would be, you know, can Smith run the offense and get him into the position to score? Then you get opportunities for McLaurin, for Gibson, for this offense to actually get it done. So, Kelsey. Oh, I love Travis Kelsey. 12 targets, 10 catches, yeah. 159.
He's not fair. He's not a fair advantage.
He is the he's got the tight end one on lockdown here. He is averaging 15.5 fantasy points per game. Waller at the tight end two position, 10.2. So he's literally, you know, 50% better than Darren Waller. That's a difference maker every week.
Every single
Well, not every week, not next week.
That well, sure, not when he's not playing. And not 3 weeks ago when he was 3 for 31. Outside of literally that single game, he's been a top six tight end every week. He's just unfair.
All right. Was that wasn't the weather game, was it?
Yes, I believe
that
it was.
That was the one
Denver.
That was the game where it was.
So maybe don't play him
in the rain?
Well, you're still going to play him. But
yeah, you are.
In the snow, lower expectations.
All right. You knew the offense wasn't going well for Chicago because Jimmy Graham had 6 targets for 6 catches, 55 yards.
Oh, man, Jimmy Grandpa.
1 touchdown, and you could do worse. That is the
you
motto.
Can.
That's the copywritten tagline for Jimmy Graham. You could do worse.
Mm-hmm.
Irv Smith?
Big Irv.
I don't know what to make of the Irv Smith game, really, because it was two. He had 2 catches. He got hurt. He scored twice, so he had 2 touchdowns.
He's a red zone option.
It's what Rudolph used to be.
Yeah, and this is the Darren Fells, or Akins. I mean, this is one of those things where the tight end leaks out on a play action. So
I would rather have Dalvin Cook. And what I mean by that is if you've got to get down near the goal line and that's where Irv Smith
can
thrive.
Are you offering me Irv Smith for my Dalvin Cook?
Yes. Yes,
I am.
Would you? Yes. Oh, for sure. If you'll accept. No, my point is.
Make for a good show, Mike.
I don't want a tight end who's touchdown dependent that is on the same team with Dalvin Cook. Mm. Because anytime they want to just have Dalvin Cook running in, they probably can.
Hockenson got into the end zone again, which was nice to see despite the quarterback getting knocked out. Evan Engram, 5 for 48 and a touchdown. He had his normal assortment of great plays and mind-boggling plays.
You got to deal with Evan Engram's buffoonery.
He got hit in the face with the football.
Look, sometimes you're not awake. You take a football in the face.
And then you make a great play.
Oh, man. He is so flashy, has big plays, has great talent, and also he just makes
sometimes,
so many
he will
mistakes.
Lose you the game if you
yes,
lean on him.
Sometimes he looks like a baby deer.
Yeah.
I get that.
A little too fast for his own good.
A little too fast, and just he doesn't have full control of his limbs.
Right.
Still learning.
Still figuring it out.
But he's still a deer, so he can be very fast.
Right.
Just a baby deer.
All right, what do you make of Jonnu Smith? He only had 2 targets, but he got back into the end zone.
And it was right at it was at the end of the game. So this was.
Do you know that Firkser had 6 targets in the same game?
This is not. It's been a downward spiral here for Jonnu.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, you know, you're happy if you score, but.
It's weird to have Jonnu Smith here in the Studmuffins and feel like he belongs in the Stinkers.
Right.
Maybe he's a both. He's a stud and stinker. Mm-hmm. Now, I will say, didn't Corey Davis goose in this game?
Oh,
I believe Corey Davis had 0. Brooks is nodding at me. So it wasn't like, oh, man, the narrative is Corey Davis is a core part of the offense now, and Jonnu's eliminated. No, it's just the offense wasn't that great in this game. Chicago's defense
is
outstanding.
Defense is great. Andy, tell me how many completions Ryan Tannehill threw.
Oh, my goodness. Well, let me think. I mean, if you know that Jonnu Smith and Corey Davis combined for 2 catches, I'm guessing you're talking like 10 to 12.
10. That's wow. right. Holy so Jonnu crap. Smith had 20% of the receiving.
So maybe
share.
A bit of an outlier game because it was Chicago.
Yeah.
But at the same time, Jonnu is a scary play.
If yep. people, you know, we're skipping the stinkers here, but if people are dropping Corey Davis because of a goose, I'd pick him
I'd
up.
Pick him up as well.
All right, let's talk stinkers.
Stinkers of the week, presented by Odor Eaters.
Presented by Tom Brady.
Tom Brady.
So, the easy thing to do with Tom Brady, 22 for 38, 209, and three interceptions, no touchdowns. Kyle Allen scored more than him, and Kyle Allen was knocked out of the game. The easy thing to do is make excuses for Tom Brady. I mean, he's had dud games before in prime time. I can remember the Kansas City game a couple years ago. He comes back out. Look, no one's more determined than Tom Brady. And look, the roster, this is like a Vince Young super team we got going on here. This is the first time, I think, that you've had three Pro Bowl wide receivers on a roster in a long time with Antonio Brown's appearance. But this is not what you hoped to see when you added Antonio Brown to the mix and got Godwin back and Mike Evans is there. And
no, it is not. And I had a flood of Twitter action because I traded for Tom Brady and everyone was like, oh, man.
Yeah.
Don't worry, everybody. I did not play him in this game. I had Josh Allen, so I was great. And I personally am not overreacting to this. The if this was something we had been seeing, and it looks like Tom Brady has maybe lost it, you know, it's going to come. But the previous 2 weeks were phenomenal from Tom Brady. So I'm not, you know, he had 648 yards and six touchdowns in the two prior games. This was a trash game, and he looked horrific.
You should just give a thank you note to the schedule makers, though, because Josh Allen, after four straight down weeks, if he's not facing Seattle this past week after what Brady had done, I can't imagine Brady's not in there.
Yeah.
Now, what do you make, though?
Thank you, schedule makers.
Out of Tom Brady, 4 of 9 weeks has been the QB 19 or worse.
I would say, well, 5 of 9 weeks he's been a top 10 quarterback. So, yeah.
That is not a consistency metric you want with a fantasy quarterback.
No, it's not. But if you look at the actual the fact that Mike Evans had been banged up, they lost Chris Godwin. He's been working with a ragtag group. Obviously, we hoped for a lot better with Chris Godwin active, Antonio Brown added to the mix. This was supposed to be the get right game. It won. You know, but you got to look
get forward. Wrong game.
It was a get wrong game. You got to look forward, and I can't imagine just saying, well, because he had one bad game,
yeah,
I'm out on Tom Brady.
But you do have to just be smart, and he's not an every week start, probably.
Seems that way.
Derrick Henry, the aforementioned Chicago game, he only went 21 for 68, no touchdowns in this game, no targets in this game. You know, Indianapolis, Baltimore, Indianapolis, the next three games. I mean, that is a prescription for pain, but he generally gets into the end zone.
Yeah, he's still getting 21 carries.
You just play Derrick Henry. There's not a lot you can say. Now, this one was a shocker.
What happened?
If there's a stat line that I was more shocked with, I can't think of it. James Conner, 9 for 22. Yeah. Against Dallas at home in a game you were favored heavily.
So bizarre. We had 11 opportunities for James Conner, who up until that point, you know, since week two, this guy was averaging, over 20 opportunities a game. I still haven't seen any reports from Pittsburgh.
46% of snaps, tons of McFarland, tons of Snell.
I don't know what happened. I apologize that I do not have an answer here.
If there was an award that we had during the stinkers segment for a player that is the stinker of the week. The stinkiest of the week. It would be Connor, and it was a shock.
Yeah.
And if you were counting on him, like we all were, ew.
Yeah, it was a terrible, horrific game, both for James Connor and for the Steelers. I think they fell asleep, assuming they could just walk right through them boys, and they couldn't. But I was upset to see the utilization. And that's something I think we're going to have to go and listen to Tomlin's pressers and see what the rationale was in not utilizing him as a three-down back. Because the nice thing about James Conner has been, if they're up, they need James Conner. If they're down, they need James Conner, and that just wasn't the case.
There have been a couple games. Sorry, Mike.
I'm curious, then. This is just narrative trying to read tea leaves, Jason, if you're saying they fell asleep. I know Mike Tomlin's a great coach, but it would be very easy to look into the trap of the Dallas Cowboys and say, we can make it through this, and maybe we can rest James Conner a little bit here. Maybe we don't have to use his body up in this matchup. That would be the hope, is the team decided that
down the whole game.
No, I know.
This doesn't make sense.
But once you have the game plan installed, you know, I've heard several times from people in the NFL around coaches. Once the game plan is installed, they very often just stick with it.
I will say this, though, and it happened in week one. There are weeks where they seem to turn the switch off for James Conner, where he does something wrong.
Week one was he got hurt, yeah. Right?
Well,
he was bad and also got hurt.
Correct. Yeah. I mean, he was so bad, and everybody came out and said he's done and he's washed.
Yep.
Watch James Conner on the bench. Watch his body language in this game from the very beginning. There was either a conversation about a blitz pickup or a mistake or something of that nature. There was a drive in the middle of the game where you imagined he'd have been out there, and even around the goal line, they were giving the ball to McFarland and to Snell, and he's sitting on the bench just looking like somebody had a talking.
Yeah, it was like an important second and short, third and short, fourth and short, three plays in a row where he wasn't involved.
Now, all that being said, he had that week one, and then they just went back and trusted him in weeks future, and that's what I would expect Cincinnati, Jacksonville the next 2 weeks. Zeke, 18 for 51. You know, he didn't look awful in this game. The matchup was tough. Yeah. I mean, this is what you're aiming for with Zeke now.
Yeah, I was going to say it was about what was expected. And sadly, every time Tony Pollard touched the ball, it was like, oh, man.
Oh, that's not Zeke.
Right. You're like, oh, Zeke's fast now. But he's got the bye week. I think you'll probably see Andy Dalton back. That's my guess. We don't know for sure.
Yeah, had they pulled the win off, I think it literally would have been different. But because they actually lost the game,
and he did have the hamstring. Remember Saturday there were the reports that Zeke may not even play,
and they have the bye, right?
Yes.
All right, Melvin Gordon and Phillip Lindsay, they did not help your team. They did nothing. J.K. Dobbins. This was one of the bigger disappointments on the week. A lot of expectations for J.K. Dobbins. He only went 12 for 30. Didn't look good.
Tough matchup with the Colts, but yes.
And then goal line work went to Gus. That's something to pay attention to.
Mm, you should have tuned into Sunday Live.
I would rather.
With me.
I would rather not. Lev Bell, you can cut him. 4 for 8. Ronald Jones, Leonard Fournette combined for how many carries? Do you know this answer? The answer is 4.
Yeah, I remember hearing at the end of the game about setting the record for fewest rushing attempts by a team in NFL history.
That's just heaping just more pain onto Brady when he was – no help to Tom Brady, no play action, no – he just was unrelentingly having to throw the football into the secondary that was beating him up.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was not good. You brought up Pollard and how he looked being shot out of a cannon compared to Zeke. So let's talk about Chase Edmonds, because it really wasn't a bad game in the sense that his fantasy production was double digits for your league. He had 3 catches, he had 25 carries, he had 70 yards. But it wasn't at all what you expected from him in this game. And the truth is, if you watch the football game, he looked absolutely identical to Kenyon Drake. Because we were all speculating around the office, like, is the first and second down run scheming for Arizona to blame for Drake's production and not, you know, a decline in skills compared to Chase Edmonds? Because every play Edmonds was getting in, you know, was a here or there passing game route, third down before the injury. Now he's the starter.
And he got all the opportunity you wanted. I mean, it was
93%.
It was as expected. 93%, 25 carries, everything you wanted, except no, no big breakaway runs, nothing. I think the scheming is to blame because we know, we've seen Chase Edmonds is very good. We've watched it this whole season. He's not
currently
injured.
He was like 5.1 a carry up to this point.
Yeah, and so I think Cliff Kingsbury needs to take a look at that and open things up for whoever the running back is.
Well, you would have also hoped for more targets.
Yeah.
Out of 93% of RB opportunities to get three targets was a problem. And, you know, you got Buffalo next week. That's an opportunity on the ground. You got Seattle the week after. But Drake will probably be either limited or out of practice this week, and you're going to have to monitor whether he's back on the field.
It does say that I expect when Drake comes back him to take back the role that was his when he left.
DeAndre Hopkins, 3 for 30. Only three targets in this game, had previously been the receiving leader in football.
Oof.
It seemed like the team was avoiding Xavien Howard for part of this game. Well, I don't know why they didn't look to Hopkins more, but they were moving the football.
He also had a lot yes. more targets. Three targets are what goes down in the box score, but that's because targets with pass interference don't. Those plays never happened in the box score, and there were like
four
pass interference calls on Howard. So Hopkins was important to the game. He took away massive amounts of coverage by being shadowed. And moved the ball on pass interference calls. So don't just ignore this one. It was bad for fantasy.
Yep. Tyler Lockett, 7 targets, 4 catches, 40 yards. So a couple down games for Lockett in a row. Metcalf has out-targeted Tyler Lockett in 4 of the last 5 games. And Tyler Lockett's been under 50 receiving yards in 4 of the last 5 games.
Wow.
So, ironically, yesterday we were watching some of these matchups, and my son asked me, he said, would you rather have DK Metcalf or Tyler Lockett rest of the season? I said, definitely DK Metcalf.
Yeah.
DJ Moore just 2 for 18. Michael Thomas, 5 for 51. First game back.
Well, first game back, and this was against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers who shut him down in week 1.
And so, they were just up so fast. Yeah, I mean, this was not a...
This was, yeah, don't worry. Michael Thomas will have better games.
Adam Thielen... I mean, between Thielen and Jefferson, only 5 catches.
The
Thielen
Vikings,
was 2 for 38.
The Vikings are the opposite Kansas City Chiefs right now.
Yes.
Where, like, the wide receivers can't do anything because they don't have to throw the ball ever. They just keep giving it to Dalvin.
So, you know, half of Thielen's games under 50 receiving yards. When the game goes to plan, they don't get the ball a lot.
Right.
Chicago next week. I'll be curious to see what they can do to slow Dalvin Cook down. The truth is they probably can't score a lot because they're Chicago. Mm-hmm. So the recipe might be, you know, if Dalvin Cook gets them out to a lead, you know, it's going to be tough counting on the receivers. They're very talented. They're always open, but they don't need to be used right now. And they're playing better football. I mean, Minnesota's winning football games.
They are.
I have this marked as the Buccaneer trio of poo-stained pants. Chris Godwin, Mike Evans, Antonio Brown. 6 targets, 5 targets. Godwin, 3 for 41. Evans, 4 for 64. Brown, 3 for 31.
This was a Tom Brady problem.
Okay.
He looked awful.
Rest of season, though. Put him in order.
Chris Godwin, Antonio Brown, Mike Evans.
Oof. So Antonio Brown, what you read off, Chris Godwin was the snap leader, 94% of snaps. Evans at 86. Antonio Brown played 78% of the snaps. That's encouraging if you had picked up Antonio Brown or you'd been stashing him in the 5 targets. So I think we can all agree that Chris Godwin would be the one of the trio, but it's difficult to navigate at this point who's the number two.
Well, and make no mistake, Antonio Brown carries way more risk than Mike Evans. Antonio Brown could not even finish the season and could not even be a Buccaneer at the end of the season. So if I had to pick who would I want on my fantasy roster going forward, it'd be Mike Evans over Antonio Brown just for risk factor. But if all three play the rest of the way, that's how I would order them.
All right, sometimes the squeaky wheel gets the grease. Sometimes the squeaky wheel falls right off the car.
Yep.
And Hollywood Brown, 5 targets, 3 catches, 38 yards, no touchdowns.
Yeah, and Lamar was getting him involved early on in the game, and then it just fell apart.
Hollywood Brown has been outside the top 39 in 7 of 8 weeks.
It's the same thing every week. He had a 21% target share. He's getting a portion of nothing.
Yeah,
it's irrelevant when he had 170 passing yards was what Lamar Jackson had the whole game, and they won 24-10.
Are you dropping Hollywood Brown? Is he a minefield for your league? You know, we talk about putting the player on waiver wire that somebody else they will sign him, and they will start him, and they will hope and pray.
Yeah,
but he has had his best game of the entire season was a wide receiver 17 number.
The only thing I would say is, man, the playoffs. The playoffs, yeah. they look juicy, but it might
not
matter.
New England, Tennessee, Pittsburgh, the next three
weeks.
Yes,
the next three are bad. Then Dallas, Cleveland, Jacksonville. That's fantastic.
But he's already played, you know, Philly. He's played Washington, Cincy. I don't know. I think I would, depending on obviously what's out there on the waiver wire tomorrow, we'll probably have the conversation again.
Yeah, Mark, yeah. You can cut him.
Sterling Shepard, he had 8 targets in this game. I don't think it was a stinker. I mean, Corey Davis, Goost, Henry Ruggs, no receptions.
Ugh, it was Nelson Aguilar who took it to 100. I mean, we knew someone was going to get a deep bomb. I was hoping it was Ruggs. It was Aguilar.
Yeah, I would rather have Aguilar at this point with his production.
Aguilar's actually been really, really good. The week prior was that weathery game where nobody on either side of the ball did anything good. But if you look back, Aguilar was the wide receiver 24, the wide receiver 10, the wide receiver 24 again.
Yeah, it was just the week I made him the start of the week that he disappeared into the weathery game.
That's right.
Yeah, it's my fault. Reaping him. All right, Rob Gronkowski. He's got poo stained pants from Tom Brady as well. 6 targets, one catch.
Now, was it his own pants, or did they all rub up against Tom Brady?
What I understand,
who produced it?
Yeah, it was
who's the producer?
Brady produced it, and he had enough to go around to like 6 or 7 pairs, so he was changing constantly and then distributing them among his teammates.
Here, throw these on.
Yeah, and I think Bruzarians may have produced some too. And
no.
You know. Tough stuff for Tampa Bay. Not what people wanted to see. I'm sure a lot of fantasy football teams lost last night, expecting some easy numbers in that game. Jared Cook, disappointing, 2 for 30. Mark Andrews, join the club.
It's another conversation of what do you do with Mark Andrews. Mark Andrews is not a drop candidate, but you've had three games where Mark Andrews was great. The tight end 1 in week 1. Back-to-back weeks as the tight end 3 in weeks 4 and 5. Other than that, though,
how many games
he's
on the year
you.
Has Mark Andrews had touchdowns in?
Is it 3?
Yeah, it's 3. Is he going to get a touchdown? This is the same exact problem of Hollywood Brown. It's a Lamar Jackson problem. It's a Baltimore Ravens offense problem. It's a Baltimore Ravens defense problem because they're phenomenal. The defense is great, and so they don't need to throw the ball a lot. And that's hurting the offense. It's really just a matter of if you get a touchdown from Lamar Jackson, which can happen, you're okay. If not, the pie is too small to be split up in unless it's going to literally 2 players and no one else is targeted in the game. Lamar Jackson just doesn't produce enough yardage for it to matter. If Mark Andrews was a wide receiver, we'd be just as upset as we are with Hollywood. But
you're exactly right.
He's a tight end, so you keep him and you keep rolling him out there because he's got as good odds at a touchdown as any other tight end. But he's not what you drafted him to be.
Which, I mean, to be honest, it's pretty much the Ravens throughout. It's Mark Ingram, too. I mean, efficiency is gone.
Yeah, last year he only had 4 games outside of the top 15. Yeah, he's already got 5.
Yeah, but the funny thing is he's on pace for 88 targets this year, and he had 98 last year. So the targets aren't
it's just touchdowns.
There's no quality. All right, Stinkers of the Week presented by Odor Eaters. Odor Eaters, the best in foot odor defense. Go to work, Odor Eaters. You had a busy week. We want to thank Pristine Auction. This week's special auction is dedicated to NFL items. Bidding starts at $20, lasts through Thursday. You can check it out at pristineauction.com and make sure when you sign up to browse all of these dedicated NFL items, you use the code BALLERS. You get a $10 credit towards whatever sports memorabilia purchase you make. So that is pretty cool. All right, waiver show tomorrow. Do your best to enjoy tonight's game. It may surprise you. And we'll talk to you tomorrow.
We will do that. Stay safe, everybody. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter at the FFBallers.
And Foot Clan, one more reminder, Simply Safe Home Security delivers an award-winning 24/7 protection with the best professional monitors in the business. Take it from us. Take it from Brooks. They got your back day and night. Get a free home security system when you purchase a Simply Safe system at, I'm sorry, a free home security camera for your system when you purchase the Simply Safe system at simplysafe.com/footballers. You also get a 60-day risk-free trial, nothing to lose, simplysafe.com/footballers.